So Alec and I haven't done a video together since August, I do believe. And this evening we were kind of messing around on, I went Aussie there, messing around on the computer a little bit, and I decided that it would be really cool in kind of preparation for Oscars and just because I wanted to, we should do a compilation of all the movies that we saw together in 2012.
Yeah. So let's get started. First movie we saw in 2012
Was
was
Haywire.
Haywire.
And I was kind of skeptical going into it at first because I'd been told that there was a lot of fighting scenes, which I'm okay with. I like a good action film, but I was kind of uncertain of how much would, if it would go too far or not. But it was very entertaining, especially the beginning when she first meets Channing Tatum. Like, the scene, I was kind of like, okay, wait, something's going to happen. They're not friends, but
And then they
oh.
have this smackdown that is just so, like, there's
Really
no
intense.
music, and you just hear bones crunching. And because the actress, and I can't remember her name, like, it was her first acting job, because she's really a mixed martial arts fighter. And so the fighting was just like, you could hear every.
Every smack, yeah. And I don't even know if they had to include like the editing smacks in there, but then there's a scene where she steals the car and she picks up the kid, and they're like running through the forest in the snow away from the cops, and it was a lot of fun, and I don't think we saw it again, but
No.
I don't know if that's a movie I'd run out to buy, but I definitely would like to see it again. If it's on Netflix, I'd watch
Yeah, it's like, it doesn't really. There's all these
it.
people in it, and in the end of it, it doesn't really matter what you just saw, because it doesn't really make much sense, but
No.
it's cool, it's fun.
Which actually kind of skip ahead to the movie Lockout, which we saw in February, March, something like that, when
Yeah.
we went to visit Brian in New York. We had to see a film that weekend for Alec to review, and there was nothing else that we wanted to see except for this movie, and we paid an ungodly price for
Yeah.
it in the
It was like
city.
80 minutes long and we spent
22
20, 20,
bucks.
20, yeah, it was ridiculous.
But I don't remember anything about that movie except thinking that the trailer was horrendous and that it wouldn't be very good. And then we saw it and it sort of had the same kind of feel that Haywire did. It was very intense and action-packed and I enjoyed it a lot. It
Yeah.
was a good experience, but I probably wouldn't have paid $22 to
No,
see
it was Guy Pearce, and it was
it.
essentially, this is a film you didn't see, a reworking of Escape from New York in a space station, basically. And it was just Guy Pearce being a badass, tossing out one-liners, like 80s style one-liners, and it was a lot of fun in that regard.
But then the second movie we saw was Journey 2 with Michael Caine,
Michael Caine,
Rishi
who's up for an
Kapoor,
adventure?
yes, and The
Which we've
Rock.
been quoting all year
We
long.
have been quoting all year
Who was
long.
up for an adventure?
Well, it's Michael Caine. He's
Yeah.
British and we like adventures thanks to Up.
Yeah.
So
And it's a silly, silly movie, but it's fun. You
it
get
is
that
fun.
peck pop of
The
love.
peck pop of love. Gosh, these movies seem like we just saw them and it was literally a year ago.
Yeah. And Journey 2 also had Dwayne Johnson's surprisingly awesome rendition of What a Wonderful World
Yeah,
on a uke.
on his uke, which I think was kind of the foundation for me wanting a uke.
Yeah.
But we saw The Hunger Games.
We
Did
did
you
see The
see
Hunger
that?
Games,
Did we
yes.
see that together?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
And we had a lively debate about the level of violence and if it was appropriate for kids to watch it.
And
And
Alec made a video about that actually that was on the Conway Daily Sun website,
yes.
and you can check it out
Yeah, we'll
right
put a
here.
link.
Link. Link. But The Hunger Games, like, it was weird for me too because everyone was like, The Hunger Games, like, all this hype was coming out, and
Because you were a student teaching at that point, you
I
had a lot of
was.
kids hearing of,
Yeah,
yeah.
and so, like, even your dad as a teacher was talking about the odd, like, the kids coming in with. Bearing the Hunger Games shirt, and it's like when you think about what the movie actually represented, for me it was hard for me to be like, oh, I wanna like have everything, because I was on the Harry Potter bandwagon. That was my Hunger Games when I was 13 and 14, and even up until I was 18. But well, 22. Okay, fine. I'm still a Harry Potter fan.
Yeah, it's all right. As long as you're not a Twilight fan.
No. But it was very hard for me to get on board with The Hunger Games because just of the context matter, like just literally like eating and killing and doing whatever you need to do in order to get past the person in front of you. Mm-hmm. Like, and that was just hard. And even like your teammate, they were put in such an awkward situation at the end, and he was in love with her and like the whole Hollywood thing, whatever. But it was just really hard for me to get on board with that. I mean, I loved the movie. I would go see it. I will see it again.
Right. And you'll see the next one, Catching Fire. Right. And it was good, and but I understand why people have a hard time, you know, maybe getting on board with it, because it is kids, and it's hard to get past that and actually just look at the commentary it's making about reality TV and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And human nature and survival of the fittest and all that kind of stuff.
And I mean, it is very heavy of survival of the fittest, like instantly when they're let off, when it first happens, and all right, the Hunger Games have now begun, like go and do your thing, instantly what, 3 or 4 people are killed. And like, that's sort of addressed with Jennifer Lawrence's character. She's kind of standing there or looking off to the side, like hiding in the bushes, like I didn't sign up for this, like,
yeah,
I did this so my sister didn't have to, but I don't want to do this.
Yeah.
Alex saw Cabin in the Woods. I am not a horror fan. Can't do it. Will not do it.
It's Joss Whedon, though, and it's good. It's good.
Yeah.
It's good.
I saw The Ring when I was like 13, 14, whatever year that came out, 2002.
Yeah.
Good job. Could do it. Thank you. I could do it back then. I could do it at 12 years old. But now that 10 years later, oh God, 10 years later, I can't. I think too much. But you saw that. 5-year engagement. I think that was probably one of the highlights of our year in movie-wise for Jason Segel. Because we'd just gotten off the Muppets high, and we're still not off the Muppets high. But
it was a really good exploration of a relationship and the things you have to do and the trials and tribulations and love persevering and
love.
And it was good. And it was a little overlong and sometimes got a little silly, but it was good. Like Jason Segel and Emily Blunt just had a really good chemistry together.
And
Alison Brie.
Love her.
Like she has this thing where it was talking like Elmo and what was
Cookie
the,
Monster.
Cookie Monster. And it's like, Elmo doesn't like you right now.
It's the best way to have a fight when a kid's in the room.
Yeah.
So Avengers was one of the biggest movies of the year, and I was so excited to see that because I haven't seen any of the other, I hadn't seen Thor or Captain America, but I was really excited for Iron Man to be back, and I was excited to see the Hulk.
Go, Mark Ruffalo.
But that movie, I think, became like Robert Downey Jr. was one of my favorite actors since I was probably 4 when my grandfather introduced him to me in Air America. But I came out of that movie and I remember marking on Facebook, I was like, this is the best Robert Downey Jr. film ever. Because it was just like Tony Stark, just fuck the what?
Yeah, it was great. And everybody got their due, and that was kind of the amazing thing about that, and it's a credit to Joss Whedon, is that you had all these different characters, and it never felt jumbled, it never felt confusing. Like, everybody got their due. No one was really, well, maybe Hawkeye a little bit. Could have had a little bit more of
Jeremy
Renner.
Then Jeremy Renner got it back with Bourne Legacy later on in the year, so.
Yeah.
Good for him.
But even Jeremy Renner was like, he knew he had to be a part of the film, because it was the Avengers, but I recently read an interview with him saying that he wished there was more with Hawkeye, and he's hoping in Avengers 2 there will be more Hawkeye. So,
Iron Man 3 comes out soon.
It's going to be dark and brooding and intense and awesome.
Speaking of dark and brooding and intense and awesome,
what could you possibly mean?
My second favorite actor of all time, Mr. Rob. Goodness.
Mr.
Johnny Depp. Dark Shadows, which is based off of a TV show
that I've never seen.
But this movie we went and saw in the drive-thru. I was so excited because it was Johnny Depp, But I was a little skeptical because I thought it was going to be scary.
It wasn't scary at all. It was really campy and silly and fun.
Yeah. And I remember, like, just being in awe, and we got out at midnight, and, like, the entire 45-minute drive home, I was just gabbing the entire time. Like, this movie was awesome. I don't understand why critics are saying it isn't. Like, it's an incredible movie. Like, I love it. It's probably my newest favorite movie. And, like, I waited all year to get it and finally got it for Christmas. So yeah. I was...
And it is, like, you like it a lot more than I do. And I don't... I like it. But we're kind of in the minority. A lot of people really dislike this movie. And I don't understand why.
I don't understand why either. Because, I mean, some of the scenes, like the whole sex scene between Johnny Depp and...
Eva Green.
It's a little silly, but, I mean...
It was fun, though.
It's fun. And it's Tim Burton, and it's his wife, and I believe now his best friend or something, so...
Yeah, he's always Helena and Johnny Depp are in everything. And I don't know. Like, I think, you know, purist of the show, it's not close enough to the show, I guess.
Maybe.
And
maybe that's why people are like, oh, it's campy and silly. Because from what I've gathered and what your mom said about Dark Shadows, the TV show, I think it was a lot darker than...
It is, and at the same time, like, I've watched it. It's really, it's basically a soap opera with a vampire.
So, Twilight?
No. I don't know. I think a lot of people at this point are just like, oh, Tim Burton's doing his Tim Burton thing, and it sucks. I'm like, well, you know, Spielberg does his Spielberg thing. Woody Allen does his Woody Allen thing. Wes Anderson does his Wes Anderson thing. Which, transition, Moonrise Kingdom is awesome. Ashley didn't see it, but I did, and it's awesome.
Which, transition into people doing their thing, Men in Black 3, Tommy Lee Jones did his thing, and... Who was the guy who played the younger version of him?
Josh Brolin.
He did his thing.
He did Tommy Lee Jones' thing and did it awesome.
Yes.
And then there was Boris. It's just Boris. Rock of Ages. Surprisingly enough, like, we can't honestly say it's a good movie.
But
we liked it.
It's fun. It's one of those, you know, musicals that you just, you know, will watch in the privacy of your own living room with a gallon of ice cream when you have nothing else to do and you don't want to go outside.
I mean, there were things about it where we just wanted to gouge our eyes out and puncture our eardrums.
What's her face?
Yeah. the leads are terrible. But then you also have Russell Brand and Alec Baldwin in their little, like, subplot love story, which is awesome. And you have Tom Cruise just...
As we said, we would buy the movie for the songs, and we would just skip through the parts we didn't like and basically focus on Tom Cruise in his, like, oh my goodness, he's almost 50.
Rock star
abs. And then the Alec Baldwin and Russell Brand
and,
love.
Yeah, and Paul Giamatti was great, too.
Yes.
And Catherine Zeta-Jones, hit me with your best shot, and we're not going to take it.
Didn't quite match her Chicago air, but...
But, so there's stuff to like about it,
yeah.
But there's also stuff to hate about it. It's a definitely good DVD rental movie, because you can just skip to all the best parts.
Yes. Which brings us to the next movie we saw, which is Brave, which I... adored.
I adored it too. And a lot of people are saying it's not that good, but people have really high standards with Pixar movies, and I guess if you put it next to, like, Up or WALL-E, it's not quite that good.
But you can't really do that because it's not anywhere near the same sort of film.
Well, yeah, I know, but they had this whole streak where they were doing all these different films, all these different styles, and they were all amazing, and I guess some people are saying, well, this isn't quite amazing as all those films, and I don't know, I still loved it. I still thought it was really charming. And
her three little brothers as the little bears.
As the cubs.
That was adorable. And then the plot with her and her mother, like, that hit me. At the moment we watched it, it hit me very deeply, so...
It's an interesting... And I wrote this in my review of it. It's a mother-daughter story, which unfortunately you almost never get in children's films. It's always father-son stories or father-daughter stories.
Well, as we were talking about the other day, actually, is children's films don't touch base on sensitive subjects anymore. They kind of go over it, like with Beethoven. We were watching Beethoven and Beethoven 2, and there are some serious adult content in that movie that nowadays I don't think would be put into film, or at least not in the blunt way it was put into Beethoven.
Like with Beethoven, which it's not like a perfect film by any means, but the villain in that, he was going to shoot Beethoven in the head.
And there was a scene where, in Beethoven 2, where Rice, the oldest daughter, was going basically to get date raped in the bedroom. And the only reason she was saved was because the dog could sense that she was in trouble. So
and it was like, thanks, Beethoven, for saving me from being raped.
So, but yeah, Brave is definitely... It's definitely a tearjerker, and definitely one that I think would be a good, like, if you have a fight with your daughter and you're older and the daughter's like 10, just be like, honey, you want to watch a movie with me? I'm so sorry we fought earlier. Yeah. Ah, you're crying.
Yeah, and another film that is, features a child in it, and she's nominated, 9-year-old, nominated for Best Actress, A Beast of the Southern Wild.
Go, girl.
And there's a film that actually deals with child and adult issues and the adult world filtered through a child's eye and just being impoverished and just seeing it from a child's viewpoint.
Yeah, some tough ones up for Best Picture this year, so we'll see.
It's a good film.
It's a very good film.
Beautiful film, low-budget film, had a fantastic score. It was like very New Orleans jazzy kind of score.
Mm, that's definitely a movie I will want to own and have on hand.
Yeah. Oh, and shame on you, the Academy, for not nominating that score for Best Original Score.
Yeah.
Shame on you. John Williams does not need to be nominated for the upteenth time.
Because he's basically gotten to a point where he's just mimicking anything from Harry Potter to Hook. So.
Yeah.
Love you, John Williams.
But. Yeah, but, you know, and... But yay for the Oscars for nominating Ted for Best Original Song.
Which, if you click right here... Right over Kirby.
You can see this guy here talking about it.
Yeah, that was a good time. But the best film of the year, hands down, which Oscars didn't nominate for.
No.
But it would win my personal Oscar, is The Dark Knight Rises.
You mean The Dark Knight Rises?
You mean The Dark Knight.
The Dark Knight.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm slightly obsessed with Christopher Nolan, only just slightly. Haven't thought about turning this one into a play yet, but when Inception came out 2 years ago, I had that one, like, I have a notebook somewhere. It's like, Inception, the play. So.
Nice.
Yeah.
We went all the way to Massachusetts to see it on an actual IMAX screen.
6 hours round trip.
You know, got the hotel, like, spent way more money than you should spend to see a movie. But it was worth it.
So worth it.
It was so worth it.
We saw it in a sold-out IMAX of 500 people.
Yeah.
And we were smack dab in the middle just, of the screen.
And this was the whole time.
With subwoofers.
That was the whole time. Just
basically. And, like, this one has a hard time sitting still if the restroom facilities need to be used. He sat still for 3.5 hours, basically.
No, it was 2 hours and 45 minutes.
Plus line waiting.
Oh, that's true. Line waiting and then the sitting, yeah.
So 3.5 hours.
Yeah.
So you can tell this movie's worth something.
Yeah. And then, going back to Jeremy Renner, Bourne Legacy. And I had to introduce this young lady here to Bourne. And I gave her a crash course before we saw Bourne Legacy.
So hooked. I was like, why didn't I see this? Why, everyone should see these movies. Why hasn't more people seen these movies?
And Bourne Legacy is the Bourne-less film, but it's still really well done and really clever in the way it's kind of like a parallel story to the Bourne Ultimatum, the third Bourne film, and it kind of, the action runs parallel with that film, and it's really cool how it kind of integrates it into the story, and I can't wait. I hope there's another one where you have Bourne and Aaron Cross was Jeremy Renner's character.
Matt Damon is out. He's not doing any more Bourne.
He might. There's so, like, if the script is good, he would do it, he says.
I would like to see a Matt Damon and Jeremy Renner mash up there.
Yeah, I want it.
Timothy Green, which we actually already discussed, so we won't go any further, but you can click that annotation, source fed, right there. Premium Rush, which we actually didn't technically see until 2013 because we waited and rented it on the Redbox.
Yeah.
But it probably, if we had seen it, if North Conway had, you know, cooperated and actually put it in the theaters,
yeah,
we would have been first in line because Joey Gordy, my third favorite actor.
Yeah, and it was a good year. He would have had Dark Knight Rises.
Yeah.
He had Looper, which this one didn't see, but it is awesome, and Premium Rush, and he was a boss in Lincoln.
He was a boss in Lincoln.
So this was the year of Joseph Gordon. It was like, booyah, Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
But Premium Rush, like, I'm desperately working to get him on a bicycle. Mm-hmm. And this movie, like, I was like, this is not going to happen. We will make sure you have brakes.
I sweat. I had my hand on my jeans. I, like, sweat through my jeans. Like, it was down to the flesh. Like,
yeah.
It's that kind of film. It's, like, it's not heavy on plot. It's just, like, he has this package. He needs to get somewhere. And there's this crooked cop chasing him. And it's all these insane bike chases.
Oh, what's his name, crooked cop guy?
Michael Shannon.
I have never liked that man, and this movie, this role does not make me like him anymore.
He's despicable, but the funny thing about him, he's like just smart enough to just be a nuisance for Joseph Gordon-Levitt, but he's also
dumb enough
that it's very, very easy to work around him.
Yeah, it's just like, why are you, you're stupid.
Yeah.
But definitely, it's going to be in our collection, I believe.
Oh, yeah.
And then
we gotta watch all the making of stuff, because it's just...
Yeah, and because there was a clip we saw on YouTube where Joseph Gordon did most of his, or a lot of his own stunt work, and there's a clip where he's, like, got his arm up and it's covered in blood because he had done a crash scene where he's supposed to, I think, just land on top of a car, and he went through the window.
Yeah, and they actually put it in the credits. They're just like, look at the blood.
Look at the
he's
blood.
He's so proud. We should get you to the hospital.
Yeah. But that brings us to Seven Psychopaths, which we saw together, which... we did discuss on Alec's show, which it wasn't as convincing. The trailer wasn't as convincing as we thought the movie ended up being.
I see that this is an example, and we have encountered this a few times this year, where the trailer didn't match the final product. And I still like Seven Psychopaths.
Yeah.
But it is far more violent and graphically gory violent than the trailer leads you to be, which makes it out to kind of be like this kind of campy, silly, satirical film. And it has that aspect, but it's also very dark and very weird.
Yeah. And I was looking forward to, like, the campy Christopher Walken. And that didn't quite do it.
Which brings us to Flight.
Flight is up for... Denzel, I think, is up for Best Actor, which... he totally deserves in this film because he touched some areas that were very intense. And I'm sure he had to go to a very dark place in order to get there.
I think any other year he probably would win, but he's up against Daniel Day-Lewis as Lincoln. So
I think hands down, sorry, Denzel, but...
yeah, it's hard. I mean, we're kind of doing this out of order a little bit, but Lincoln is just amazing. It really brings history alive. I mean, I talked about this on my show recently. It's going to be shown in history classes and actually probably will make kids interested in the passing of the 13th Amendment.
As I said, like, I wasn't a big history fan in school. I had a hard time obtaining all the information and making it register. And for me, like I was saying, if I had had this at 10 years old, I would have hand down been like, you know what Lincoln did? You know what he had to go through? I would have been like, this is the greatest thing ever. Why didn't someone show me this? So
yeah, it's just really well done. Everybody, Tommy Lee Jones, again, you know, he just does his Tommy Lee Jones thing, but it's so much more depth and substance to it.
Yeah.
And there's
some twists in that just be like, wow.
Yeah. Wow.
And I think if I watch Lincoln again, knowing some of these things, like the twists and different things, like I would look for more of that in his acting, especially for Tommy Lee
Jones. I think with, Tommy Lee Jones, there's a final reveal with his character. And I think they're going back. There's going to be some scenes where he's kind of just quietly being introspective. And it just brings a whole other meaning and context.
Right. Especially like in the... House of Representatives when they're having their big spiels and he's just kind of sitting there like, all right.
But again, to just touch on Flight, really good film. Again, another film that doesn't really, the trailer doesn't really do the film justice in that it really is this dark character study about a man who's an alcoholic, and basically the film is him coming to terms with the fact that he does have this problem, and he does do this great heroic thing, but he also has a problem, and doing this heroic thing helps him come to terms with it, and it's very well acted and very well done.
Very good. And then fun film of the year was Rise of the Guardians, which, again, is kind of like Dark Shadows for us, is that it's a movie that we absolutely love.
Oh, yeah.
Like, we convinced Alec's dad to go with us, and he was kind of like, I don't really want to see
that. He was on
movie.
The fence.
And then at the end, it was one of those, I don't want to admit it, but I enjoyed that.
And unfortunately, not a lot of people went to see it, and I think it's a shame, because it's probably one of the best holiday themed films to come out in a long time.
Yeah.
Like, it isn't just a Christmas film, but I could certainly see watching it every Christmas or every Easter, or just having it's
every Christmas from now on. We're going to watch Jingle All the Way, this movie, Santa Claus, hands down.
Okay, as long as I get Ernest Saves Christmas every other year.
Okay.
And Rise of the Guardians had Russian Alec Baldwin
as Santa. And a preview of Hugh Jackman as the Easter Bunny.
Yeah.
Which brings us to, out of order here again from how we saw them, but Les Mis. Which, hands down, is probably going to go home with some Oscars this year. Especially Miss Hathaway.
Oh, Miss Anne Hathaway.
Yes.
Hathaway of winning an Oscar.
Oh,
yeah.
There you go.
I stole that one.
Yeah, because I said that.
Yeah. But I also stole it from Mike Myers and Dana Carvey. Yeah, the singing is it's imperfect, but that's what makes it so great, because it's raw and full of emotion, and this was what made this film sort of revolutionary, is that it was all performed live. There was no playback, and you can sense the emotion. It's all present there in the moment.
And because of that, I can't wait for the movie to come out and all the special features, because that will be like a day where I just watch everything that's on the extended portion of that film.
And just absorb it.
And absorb everything. Talking about going back to, like, we ended the year kind of on the same note that we started it. We ended it on a action-packed adventure movie with Tom Cruise there.
Yeah.
Different level from middle of the year for him with Rock of Ages, but Jack Reacher, I actually picked a book up this summer that was a Jack Reacher book. I hadn't read it yet, but I was very intrigued by the book, from what I read on the back page. And when Alec told me that this was basically the same thing, I was so excited to jump on board. And for any action fan, like, this is probably a movie you'll want to own, especially with Robert Duvall's.
Yeah, Robert Duvall is a shooting range owner, and he becomes a very pivotal figure in the final third of the film. And a lot of people are ragging on it, because in the book, I haven't read any of the Jack Reacher series, but he's described as being like 6'5" and big and burly, blonde hair, and people are like, oh, Tom Cruise can't pull that off. And it's like, okay, so maybe he doesn't look like the character, but he has to do some kind of intense fighting scenes, and it's believable. And a lot of people are just saying, oh, he's doing his Tom Cruise smiling all the time thing. And it's like, did you even watch the movie? Because it was a very restrained, you know, gritty kind of performance.
Tom Cruise smiling? Top Gun.
Yeah.
Tom Cruise as cocky Tom Cruise? Rain Man. Tom Cruise actually doing something awesome? Jack Reacher.
Yeah. And he wasn't doing, I'm Tom Cruise. Hey, Tom Cruise. He wasn't doing that.
Jack Nicholson?
Yeah, Jack Nicholson is Tom Cruise. Hey.
Hey.
And I'm Tom Cruise. Hey.
But I think we're going to end our lovely year with the last movie we saw, which was The Hobbit.
The Hobbit.
And this is a movie that, in our personal lives and in Alec's career, has been one that's been very...
contentious?
been a little on a debating issue here, that we both liked it.
We liked it.
And I own all three of the Lord of the Rings movie with all the special features, and I have watched all of them multiple times because I'm the type of person that I love obtaining as much knowledge about a film or anything for that matter as I can. So I'm with the hardcore Tolkien fans here. When The Hobbit comes out on DVD, I will watch everything that they give to me to watch. But I can also look at it with, you know, a critical eye and say that The Hobbit did have some things that didn't necessarily need to be in there to make the movie good. That doesn't necessarily mean the movie was bad. It just means that for someone who wants to go see a film but doesn't want it to comprise the whole day, that the movie could have been probably an hour.
The Hobbit should not take 9 hours to tell. Let's just put it that way.
And so for a short way of putting this, we won't let him go into full detail, but there have been multiple conversations and many videos and conversations that he has had in person with people who they butt heads a little.
Yeah. I have my reservations. I still like it. My friend Brian loathes it with a passion, a deep, deep passion, because he just loves the book so much. And he says he'll never see it ever again.
No. And then our beloved and Alex's beloved editor of his show, Bill,
is on the exact opposite. He loves every single frame of it. So I have two polar opposite people in my life who are just like, it's great, it's perfect, it's the worst thing ever made. And I'm in the middle like, I liked it.
So, yeah. But out of all of these movies made this year, 2012 was a very, very good year.
Yeah.
Especially in film. And so we're very excited to watch the Oscars. I got a little verklempt just saying that. So I imagine the Oscars are probably going to be an emotional time for me this year.
Yeah. Because
a lot of these films I attach myself to personally. Which I think if you can do that with anything creative, then it's doing something right.
Yeah. Quick, top three films of what films you saw.
Top three films of the year. Let's see. Dark Knight Rises. Probably Rise of the Guardians. This is hard. I want to say Dark Shadows, but
we can kick it up to five.
Okay. Dark Shadows. Definitely Les Mis and Ted.
Ted? Ooh, Avengers didn't make it.
No, I told you that. I had my reservations with Avengers. But, well, it's because it's one of those things that I loved it when I saw it, but now I can't remember much.
Well, okay. And you slept through it the second time. Yeah. I don't know what my top five would be. My top five, okay, not even saying the best movies, but the most fun I had seeing a movie, like with Miss Girlfriend here, Rise of the Guardians. Was a wonderful time. 5-year engagement was a wonderful time. Journey 2, wonderful time with Miss Girlfriend. What is that? That's three, right?
You're up to three.
Avengers was a wonderful time, and Dark Knight Rises was a wonderful time. Those would probably be my favorite movie-going experiences with Miss Girlfriend.
Oh, look at that. 2 out of 5.
Yeah. And Dark Shadows, too. So.
Well, let's put it this way. I had fun at all of them.
Yeah.
But
those were just really memorable experiences. Oh, and Ted was good too with Kirby here. We brought Kirby into the movie with us. It was wonderful. So yeah, that was our year in movies. We'll see how 2013 turns out.